Starting. Okay, we're now live. Hello and welcome to the talk through, I should say, since I'm doing the talking. Just to introduce myself. So my name is Chris Linnell. I am the founder of the Canadian Longevity Association and a longtime advocate for longevity. I've been following longevity for the science of longevity, I should say, for the past 25 years. So I've got a little bit of knowledge in the area, but in the last 10 years, I really took a deep dive and got lost down in the PubMed rabbit hole, where you can find basically any scientific study you so desire. And for the last 3 years, I've been writing a monthly newsletter where I sort and compile the most interesting scientific studies of a particular month and present them to people. However, my newsletters can be a little bit dense or maybe a little bit scary for the uninitiated to look at, since they mainly consist of links to various scientific papers. So I'm now doing a video walkthrough or talk through of the most interesting studies which have come out in the preceding month. This time it is April's turn to be looked at, and that's what we're going to be doing now. This is my, I should warn you that this is only my third time attempting to use Facebook Live. Last month I had a couple of attempts and all sorts of problems came up. And again, today some more problems came up, but I'm not going to sit here and complain about Facebook Live. All I can say is that these videos will get better over time. So please bear with me as I am learning how this system works. Anyway, without further ado, let's take a look at this month's longevity review. Oops. Where's it gone? No, it isn't. Here it is. Anyway, so here is the newsletter we are going to be taking a look at. Starting off, I mean, I just mentioned a few things, but to start off with some CLA news, I mean, the biggest news was the fact that I started a YouTube channel, which you might be watching this on already, and that's sort of the main news from the CLA last month. Canadian Longevity YouTube channel is right there in front of you. As part of the newsletter, I also have a little section's Canadian Spotlight, focusing on any Canadian companies or organizations devoted to longevity as well. And this month, I just wanted to highlight You Are Unlimited, or your UNLTD. And I've met the people behind this website, and they are fellow travelers on the longevity road. Quite a few interesting articles can be found here. In fact, these are the two people I have met, and yes, they very much agree that the longevity, our longevity future is something that is a positive, that the longevity economy, so to speak, will provide numerous opportunities for society as opposed to detriments, as so many people fear in terms of the great tsunami. Anyway, go check them out, you can find some interesting articles on their site. Going back to the newsletter, so I always have in the roundup section the five or six most interesting studies from the previous month, and I'll talk you through the five best ones from April, starting with a really, really exciting paper. I was actually thrilled when I saw this. Now, this paper combining stem cell rejuvenation and senescence targeting to synergistically extend lifespan is a preprint. So it hasn't actually gone through the full peer review process and hasn't been published in a journal. And normally I do not, does get published probably a year's time or something like that. So I wanted to highlight it to you today. And the exciting thing about this paper is that it combines two of the most promising fields in longevity, which are senolytics and partial reprogramming. Now, senolytics, just to briefly remind you, is well, I should say senescence in total is when basically we've got some when cells in our body become old, but past their sort of sell-by date, they can either be removed by the body or they can unfortunately persist, sit around acting almost like zombie cells, secreting inflammatory molecules and things like that. Now, if they can be removed, that will lead to various improvements in people's health. And for the last, I don't know, 6 or 7 years, senolytics, since they've been discovered, there's been so much excitement in the field around them, and they're currently in early phase human trials. Now, partial reprogramming involves basically winding back the epigenetic clock to a more youthful state. So it's sort of rejuvenating cells. So you can take an old cell from a 100-year-old person, and by partially reprogramming, you could make it appear to be like the cell of a 20-year-old. Now, I've been saying for a long time that there's never going to be a single silver bullet which is going to defeat aging or cure aging or lead to enhanced longevity for us. It's going to only going to be through the combination of various treatments that we are going to be able to get a handle on aging. And well, the reason I wanted to show this paper was, again, here is a combination treatment using these two exciting new areas in longevity. And as the paper itself says, there was a synergistic response to them. And what does that mean? Well, let's scroll down to the lifespan studies. I should say this was done in flies. So, where it is? Let's make this bigger so you can actually see what it is. So there we go. So if you take a look at this, the control flies are in gray here. When they were given gray on all these. When they were given a senolytic treatment, which is, I believe, is the green, they initially, lived longer, sort of healthier in earlier old age. So you can see they lived longer, but then there was a dramatic drop off. When they used partial reprogramming, the sort of the survival, which is the red line here, the survival curve sort of shifted to the right. When, however, they used both, we get the blue line, whereby not it's sort of again it's added extra. So sort of took the benefits of both the senolytics and the partial reprogramming to produce a much bigger boost to the longevity of the flies. So it sort of seems that senolytics worked at the beginning better, partial reprogramming worked better in the long in the long run. But this paper is actually, it's fairly readable, and especially the discussion is worth taking a look at. But yes, very exciting paper. Another very interesting study which came out is not the sort of a typical longevity study, but is all about a weight loss drug. So here, obviously, there have been numerous, or I should say an anti-diabetes drug that can also be used for weight loss. As you may or may not be aware, obesity or excess weight is an age accelerant. So people who are overweight tend to age faster than people who are sort of a normal body weight. And obesity causes all sorts of age-related complications, raises your risk of cancer and heart disease and all those other things. So simply by someone reducing their weight, there are numerous health benefits attendant to that. And also, it's potentially very useful for longevity. Anyway, this new diabetes drug, let's go to the press release. It's Lilly's, the pharmaceutical company, tirzepatide, basically, well, led to, as it says there, 22.5% weight loss in adults with obesity or who were overweight, which is a huge, huge weight loss. And long-term results aren't in, but I imagine this would lead to quite a number of health benefits. So, I don't know if anyone has ever tried to lose weight, but the older you get, the harder it is to lose weight. The whole diet industry wouldn't exist if it were easy for you to lose weight. So anything that can help with that, especially something that can, you know, produce 20% reduction, that is certainly something to be celebrated and could actually make quite a big difference to our society, especially our Western overweight societies, I should say. Now, next study to sort of take a look at involves actually my current favorite longevity drug, or at least I think the drug which I believe is closest to prime time, or closest to making a difference. That drug is rapamycin, which was the very first drug proven to extend the lifespan of mammals back in 2009. And a lot of people are now self-experimenting with it. I hope to be as well pretty soon. Excuse me. Now, one thing in the past, people have thought that rapamycin was basically recapitulating certain aspects of caloric restriction and didn't provide any extra benefit to that. However, more and more studies have come out showing that rapamycin actually is quite different from caloric restriction, actually operates on a molecular level quite differently. And this paper backs that up, because this paper involved the combination of rapamycin with caloric restriction. And as it says here, as the paper itself is called, distinctive and additive effects of calorie restriction and rapamycin in aging skeletal muscle. So they had different effects, but they could be combined. They're additive. So basically, both doing caloric restriction and using rapamycin at the same time obviously provides even more benefits to muscles than they would each individually would do. So again, I've mentioned it before, things that are combinations, I'm very much for, and here's another combination that provides benefit. Moving further on, here, this fourth highlighted paper is quite interesting because it's something that is very much actionable today. And purportedly, it is saying that the combination of vitamin D, omega-3, so omega-3s from fish and stuff, and a simple home exercise program may reduce cancer risk among active adults aged 70 or older. And I believe, let me just check, did I write it down? Reduced invasive cancer risk by 61%, which is massive. I mean, the participants, they were mean age, basically they were 75 years old, and they were followed for a couple of years, I believe, 3 years. Hold on. Trying to remember. Yeah, follow up for 3 years. And in that time, there was, as I say, it's around 60% reduction in the risk of invasive cancer. So I guess, what does invasive cancer mean? I guess invasive cancer, I mean, they're benign cancers which just stick in one place and are not actually going to kill you. And their cancer becomes invasive. That means it spreads in the body and it's basically invasive cancer which kills you. So anything that can reduce that is great. And as I say, this seems to suggest that, you know, so a simple combination, again, combinations once again, vitamin D, omega-3, as home exercise can slash that risk. But of course, although there were for 2,000 participants, you know, again, at the end of this study, they always say extra further study is warranted. Larger trials would be warranted to confirm these results. But still, quite interesting. And lastly, here is a diet that may confer certain longevity benefit. And this is from a guy called Walter Longo, who you may or may not know, was one of the first people to really start elucidating the benefits of fasting. And has also developed a fasting mimicking diet whereby you basically get a package for over the course of like 5 days. You eat very, very little, but it makes your body think that it is fasting for 5 days, and you can get quite a bit of benefit. But anyway, here in this paper, he basically explains, this is kind of a review of the work he has done in the past. And one interesting thing is that there's war on carbs to a large degree, whereas he's saying that actually, you know, in terms of all the studies that he's looked at and all the work that he's done, actually, we shouldn't completely cut carbs out. I mean, it's important what carbs we eat. And obviously, if you're only eating processed carbs, you should switch to, whole grains and minimally processed carbs. But this is quite interesting. Also, it's fairly short and a good overview of a lot of the science when it comes to the best diet for longevity. So I wanted to include that in the roundup this month, just because I wanted to include something that, again, that was actionable, that rather than talking about some far future when some amazing therapies come through, it's important also to be able to do things now as opposed to waiting for some miracle breakthrough down the line. You want to be still alive for when that miracle breakthrough comes through. Anyway, moving on to the supplemental section. So after I've selected the top five papers, then we get through to all the subsections. And I won't go through all of them because there are a lot, but I'll just point out a few interesting ones. Now, there are a number in the fasting sort of section, there are a number of other actual clinical trials which are looked at a form of fasting which is called time-restricted eating, which is actually which something that I follow, whereby you only eat all your calories or all the food in one day in a specific time period, a reduced time period, less than 12 hours. So you might have heard of the 16-8 diet, where you fast for 16 hours every day and only eat during an eight-hour window. So a couple of studies here were looking at whether or not time-restricted eating would be better for weight loss than just cutting your calories. And well, both these studies sort of said that they're kind of they're saying that it's quite similar to cutting your calories, or didn't provide huge amounts of extra benefit. However, looking at the papers more closely, although there wasn't a statistically significant difference, adding time-restricted eating to calorie restriction actually did provide extra benefit. Looking at the actual numbers, I mean, yeah, didn't quite reach statistical benefit statistical significance, but again, the eyeball tests showed that the people who did time-restricted eating lost more weight than those who simply just cut their calories. So probably is beneficial to add time-restricted eating to calorie restriction if you're trying to lose weight, or even for general health, health and longevity purposes. Going through again, I'm not going to go look at everything here. Again, sort of diet, the healthy diet, the Southern European Atlantic diet pattern, again, similar to the Mediterranean diet, basically. Again, all these sort of healthy diets involve minimally processed foods. Again, stuff you already know about eating as many. Eat lots of fruits and vegetables and cut down on processed meats and all of those things. Was there anything here? Oh, yes. In the exercise section, just saying briefly, pointing out if you didn't know it already, here's a dose response association between step count and cardiovascular disease risk. And maybe unsurprisingly, the more you walk, the lower your cardiovascular risk is. So, I mean, try to aim for around 10,000 steps a day. The more, the better. I think actually up to like going to zero, from zero to around 7,000 steps a day, you know, there's a huge increase in benefit. The benefit starts to sort of slow down at, the increased benefit so starts to slow down after 7,000 steps, but still there's greater benefit from 10,000 than 7,000 steps. Certainly after 10,000, it really does plateau, and there's not humongous or there's minimal benefit for walking even more than 10,000 steps in a day. Just skip over that. So now looking at non-prescription supplements, so basically supplements you can buy in any health food store or online. Again, I won't go into all of these, just pick out a couple things. These are all most of these are ones that I do take myself or have taken myself at certain times. Don't always have everything in stock at the same time, right? Get lazy as well, I guess. So, was there anything here? Just reminding myself. Yeah, I mean, curcumin is, here's a study on curcumin. I didn't have the study itself, but it's the PubMed. So just saying that a meta-analysis of, so looking at not just one a handful of trials, but basically looking at every trial that's been published, basically seems to indicate that there was a significant beneficial effect of curcumin supplementation on improving body weight, BMI, and levels of various biomarkers. So basically saying that curcumin is, which is of course the active ingredient in turmeric, the yellow spice used in curries, Indian curries. So we're basically saying that yes, curcumin has a beneficial effect looking at all the studies that have come out in it so far. Here, going into melatonin. So melatonin is quite often used for as used as a sleep aid, and that's actually the main reason why I take it myself. However, when I was producing these reports after a couple of years, I was seeing so many papers on melatonin that I decided to include it as a longevity supplement as well. And interesting, this paper here seems to indicate that melatonin could be beneficial for Alzheimer's. It says that this report provides evidence for the potential benefits of exogenous, which basically means you eat it, you take it in, because it's produced endogenously. Endogenous means from our own bodies. Exogenous means from outside of our bodies. So taking melatonin, especially medium low dose melatonin, could be beneficial for Alzheimer's, which is a good thing. Anyway, moving on to another quite popular and relatively new longevity supplement, which is nicotinamide mononucleotide, NMN, as it's better known as, which is a NAD precursor. Now, NAD is a molecule which is very important for the daily operation of our bodies using multiple different processes. Unfortunately, levels decline with age, and the idea is if you could raise those levels up again, there will be good health benefits. There are actually two sort of newish, what's it called, precursor molecules, which sort of turn into NAD in the body. Nicotinamide riboside down there and nicotinamide mononucleotide. Personally, I take NMN, as do my parents. It's a bit newer than nicotinamide riboside or NR. So it's taken a little bit longer for human studies to come out for NMN, and they've only sort of started coming out last year or so. And here is yet another new study in humans. And this is more sort of phase one, just checking that it is safe and whether or not it actually does increase NAD levels in the body. And in this small trial, only like 30 people were involved, a dose of 250 milligrams a day for 12 weeks did increase NAD levels. This is, as it says here, NAD levels in whole blood were significantly increased after NMN administration. It caused no abnormalities in physiological or laboratory tests, and no obvious adverse effects were observed. So indicating at least, most importantly, that it seems to be safe for use, because let's face it, the last thing we want to do is to be taking a supplement in the hope of helping our longevity, and then it causing actually causing us a problem. So again, doesn't prove that NMN is producing health benefit in this study, but again, at least showing that it's safe and it actually does increase the levels of NAD in the body, which is promising. And hopefully in the next year or two, a lot more studies are sort of coming out, and we might actually find out whether it's more than if it's just safe and if it actually does provide a benefit, or is it, if it is just the case that we're wasting our money on a not exactly cheap supplement, though fortunately the price has come down substantially in the last couple of years. It's more than halved in price, which is good. What else? Looking down here. Oh yes, resveratrol, which was like around 10 years ago, or maybe 15 years ago now, was sort of quite exciting, hot supplement, which was going to make us all live forever. And then after the initial period of hype, it sort of all sorts of questions emerged, and it's certainly not the elixir that people were maybe thinking initially. However, it does appear to have benefits. And in this paper here, which is again another one of these meta-analyses and systematic reviews, it is saying that that resveratrol has a dramatic impact on regulating lipids and glucose metabolism. And the major clinical value of, well, it's saying, okay, more clinical value if you're obese or a diabetic. But anyway, showing that, just another study showing that there is at least some benefit to resveratrol. I've taken it. I don't currently have any. I haven't taken it for a few months, but I no doubt will be taking it again at some point. What else did I wanted to point out? Moving other available supplements. Yeah, just saying that here was a study showing that krill oil, which is a sort of more expensive version of fish oil. I think it's more expensive. Improved the muscle function and size in older adults. And one of the things that krill oil has, which normal fish oil doesn't, is that it is a source of astaxanthin, which is actually a supplement I take on its own anyway. As the results here, krill oil supplementation results in statistically and clinically significant increases in muscle function and size in healthy older adults. So that's good. What else? Again, I got this little section here of combinations, because again, if I get excited whenever there's a any form of combination is being tested. Here a couple more sort of combinations: curcumin, or artemisia, bromelain, and black pepper can help potentially with diabetic macular edema. I'm not sure how it's pronounced. And also potential benefit of statins and metformin for resistance training in older adults, because one thing, resistance training is very, very beneficial when you're older. Well, it's beneficial all stages in life, but especially when you're older, when you're losing muscle mass, and resistance exercise will help counteract that. Let's see, metformin, was there anything exciting? A few things, yeah, really, yeah. People taking people to type 2 diabetes taking metformin had a lower fatality rate if they had a stroke. Was there
Yeah, so age-related macular degeneration, did it improve? Yeah, so metformin users were less likely to develop age-related. It says there, metformin users were less likely to develop age-related macular degeneration. Metformin is a supplement. Well, it's a prescription supplement I have not taken yet myself. Yeah, I mean, certainly popular in the longevity crowd. Much more exciting, as I said before, rapamycin. Actually, metformin and rapamycin together, combination, well, yet again, seems to provide added benefit. Okay, talked about rapamycin in the roundup, so won't quite go through all of these. Anything exciting? Just reminding myself. No, but yeah, various papers there. Other sort of miscellaneous other molecules. Oh yeah, so I just mentioned one again. Humans concentrating on human studies here. If you suffer from or I can't pronounce it, Dupuytren's disease, which is basically may causes fibrous buildup in tendons and causes your hands to sort of curl up eventually. Something I'm going to suffer from. My dad has it. He's had a couple operations on his hand already. But yeah, there's a potential anti-tumor necrosis factor medication, which adalimumab, what on earth that is, which basically seems to prevent the progression of Dupuytren's. So something, at least for me, something to look forward to. At least that if it turns out that I've inherited because it's a genetic disorder. If I've inherited it from my dad, then maybe it's hope for me that I won't actually develop the full-blown disease. Moving on to other areas of interest, so away from sort of supplements or drugs, but just sort of areas of other areas of longevity. Yeah, here we go. So, talked about partial cellular reprogramming, that paper in Flies at the beginning of my talk today. Here's another interesting paper. Oops, full text. Here we go. Basically, so here, partial cellular reprogramming. Well, it says there it enhances liver plasticity and regeneration in mice. So, basically, yeah, it's I should also mention that, yeah, partial reprogramming is a very, very new field. So papers are only now, last year or so, actually the last few months really, our papers are finally starting to come out about this. And here's yet another one, again showing that it has benefits in benefits for the liver, by basically making the liver a bit younger and acting like a younger liver so that it regenerates more proficiently. As it says there, reprogramming has beneficial effects on regenerative capacity. I mean, partial reprogramming is probably good, at least a good 10 years away, but as I say, it could be a real game changer, especially when combined with senolytics, as we found out earlier. What else do I want to bring out? Oh yeah, here's some here's a paper on gene editing. So you're going to the silence daily because it's behind a paywall. But basically here, experimental gene silencing to reduce the blood levels of lipoprotein A, a key driver of heart disease risk, by up to 98%. So, use of it should have a substantial impact on heart disease risk or cardiovascular disease risk. And it's interesting to see that they have a gene therapy for that. And again, this is in humans. It's only, though it is, I should say, it is a phase one trial, so very early stage, but this is not in mice, but in humans. And it's good to see the gene therapy is are moving forward. What else? What else? A few different lifespan extending interventions here, though most of these are mice. Yeah, most of these deal with flies and worms, but still, it's always good to see new compounds or new molecules which extend lifespan, regardless of which organism. Here is something I wanted to point out, again, which is actionable. People are becoming increasingly aware of the importance of sleep to our general health and indeed our longevity. And for a long time, we've heard bandied around that everyone needs 8 hours of sleep, and people can get stressed that they are not getting those 8 hours of sleep. Well, it turns out that, at least according to these researchers, that the actual optimal level of sleep is 7 hours if you're middle-aged or older, which she made me happy because that's around how long I sleep every night. When I was younger, I was worried about the fact that I wasn't getting 8 hours, or I couldn't sleep for 8 hours. And well, it turns out that maybe it's a good thing. So everyone is different, but still, it's good to know you don't need to worry about getting those 8 hours or 9 hours or whatever that some people believe you need to get. Just mention again, I mean, this is not exactly new news, but make sure you watch your blood pressure, because associating cumulative blood pressure with cognitive decline, dementia, and mortality. So, cut a long story short, the higher your blood pressure is and the longer it is high, the worse the outcome is, basically. So, whatever you need to do to reduce your blood pressure, please try to do it, because there was a strong dose response relationship. No, don't search. Which meaning the higher blood pressure, the longer it was high, the worse outcomes there were. Going further down. Oh yeah, one thing I wanted to mention is that I've just started. I think this is the first month I did it. Yes, I added an extra little section on reproductive health, overaging and all that type of thing. Also could maybe be considered also sort of more female health. Yeah, I guess maybe simply because I have no interest in children myself, so I've haven't really followed it. Well, I haven't really followed reproductive health that closely, but of course that is very important to many people, and especially women, maybe in their 30s, approaching that the clock is ticking. And obviously longevity interventions should not only improve our healthy longevity, but also increase our reproductive longevity, especially for women who reach menopause and lose the ability to have children. Hopefully, their window of opportunity will increase. anyway, so just wanted to mention that there's this new section I've started adding. Not that I completely just ignored it before. It just you know, it just didn't have its own specific section. What else? Senolytics, of course, every month there's tends to be a number of senolytic papers coming out involving new ways to clear senescent cells, like this one here, combining adoptive NK natural killer cell infusion with a dopamine releasing peptide reduces senescent cells in aged mice. They're always discovering new compounds or new methods for that. And also here, short-term senolytic treatment is useful for fracture repair. So, what do they use? They used our old friends dasatinib and quercetin. So, human self-experimenters are using this combination. In fact, that's the first senolytic combination that was discovered and is actually in human clinical trials as we speak. But turns out that it improves fracture repair, bone healing in aged mice. So just yet more evidence that the removal of senescent cells is beneficial. Yes, here's an interesting study which backs up something I'd seen before, which is that the simple, here they talk about a topical emollient, which basically, as I was saying, what on earth is a topical emollient? Basically, is a skin cream. A general skin cream, you know, used for dry skin or things like that, which don't want to sound sexist, but typically it's women use skin creams more than men. But it turns out that skin creams can reduce inflammation in the skin and thereby reduce general inflammation in the body. And there are benefits to this. Here it says that, improvements in epidermal function, which is basically improvements in skin function with a topical emollient, with a skin cream, can mitigate or reduce the progression of cognitive impairment. So, the simple use of a skin cream could help your cognition in older age. These are participants who are 65 years or older. These are Chinese, but still, I don't see why it shouldn't also work in non-Chinese people. But once again, they always say the sample size was small, larger trials are needed and all that. But still, something as simple as a skin cream could be useful for longevity. What else? Is anything else I'm missing? Coming to the end here, one thing that I maybe needs its own section, but I've been sort of keep on putting it into the odds and sods section of miscellaneous things is sort of transcranial direct current stimulation. I'm seeing more and more papers in this field. So here, effects of prefrontal transcranial direct current stimulation on retention of performance gains and obstacle negotiation. I mean, basically, it's a positive. It does transcranial direct current stimulation. So basically attaching electrodes to the brain, to your skull, and somehow stimulating your brain with electricity seems to have benefits. Improving working memory, as they are avoiding obstacles, and here it's relieving chronic musculoskeletal pain. So it's interesting that yeah, this is an area which I don't really know much about. I've not really investigated, and I've sort of started noticing it more and more, these studies coming out. So it's sort of an area that deserves greater study. And I think sort of come to the close here, pretty much. I'm just seeing if there's anything else I missed. Well, I could go through every single paper here and could take several hours doing so, but I will maybe call it a close. Oops. But, these broadcasts will get better as time goes on. I was a little bit flustered because it wasn't working at the beginning, so it kind of just destroyed my train of thought. So I wasn't quite as let's see, I was losing words already. I wasn't quite as smooth in my delivery as I would have otherwise liked, but hopefully you gained some benefit. And yeah, be sure to tune in next month when I'll be doing this again in a better format, hopefully. Anyway, thank you very much, and